But I'm going to talk about my journey and the key learnings from that. I'm going to talk about what's next, which Grant alluded to, and then talk about an offer that I have for everyone that you can all benefit from. So Strictly Savvy, we provide virtual assistant services. I have a team of, I think it's 18 now, I need to do a count when I get back to the office, of team members who provide those virtual assistant services to small to medium businesses, mostly in Wellington but across the country as well. So businesses outsource their essentially office work, so from graphic design, photography, customer service, helping people with tools and apps and streamlining their business, setting up processes, bookkeeping in Xero, and they might want an executive assistant to help them with their diary and inbox management. So we do all of that from our office in Upper Hutt. We employed our first male last week too, so yes, we're mostly all females, but we now have a male on the team, so he's doing well so far, so yeah, we look forward to seeing how he goes. So my journey, I grew up in a dairy farm in the Waikato. I think that's where I get my sort of hard working nature from, my work ethic. On the farm, we were responsible for rearing the calves for my parents. We were then sent home to go cook tea for them and have everything ready when they got back. So we were definitely working and helping support our family to bring that revenue in from the dairy farm. At 11, I begged my parents to send me to a boarding school in Hawke's Bay. And I know that that's not probably the norm with people wanting to go to boarding school, but I had heard someone who had attended the school talk, and I really wanted that opportunity because they played a lot of sport and I loved playing sport, so I knew I'd get those opportunities there, and it just sounds like a really great school where you can get involved in a lot of things. So they said that I could go if I got a scholarship to pay half the fees, so I went and sat that exam and I got the scholarship, so I was allowed to go. Going to boarding school at 11, in hindsight, was probably a little bit too young. We were definitely, I spent, I think, 3 months away from my parents, and we had to look after ourselves. So, yes, we had the matron there, but, we had to make sure that we were up at 7 o'clock when the bell rang, got ourselves dressed, ready to go to school, put our washing out. We did our own, like, mufti clothes on the weekends, so we had to make sure that they were clean and dry, and for an 11-year-old going over to Hawke's Bay to do that, there was a lot of learning and a lot of growing up that I did, but that's where I get my independence from and probably my drive. Everything sort of fell apart for me in my life when my parents split up when I was sixth form, and I no longer went to the boarding school and I went to a public school, probably the worst public school you can imagine in Hamilton, and I tried to put myself through school. My parents had sort of moved away, and I worked at Burger King at night doing the night shift till midnight, 1 a.m, and then I would come home, try and wash my clothes, get them like hung out ready so that I could have those drive to go back to work after school. I had a car, fortunately, so I drove myself to school, and when the teachers hassled me about not turning up on time, I would, explain the situation and say, I'm doing my best, just leave me to do it. So I managed to go through to seventh form. I didn't do that well in seventh form. I knew that I could have, but I didn't have that support at home. Decided not to go to university. I didn't know what I wanted to do. And I actually think that was quite a blessing for me, because I went into a PA role and realised that I loved that variety of work, and I got to see and learn a lot of stuff. Moved down to Wellington and started working at the port as a personal assistant, and I worked for 3 of the senior managers there. They were really great guys, and I learnt a huge amount about business, and they really let me get involved in, attending the meetings, and I just learned and absorbed as much stuff as I possibly can. Going to the board meetings and the highest meetings there are, those senior managers get to hear a lot about how management works and how running a company works. I was then promoted to the EA, to the CEO at the port, and again, I just absorbed as much as I could. Went on maternity leave and had my son, and realised that I wanted to do something for myself, and I didn't want to drive to Wellington and do that commute every day, so I lived in Upper Hutt. That's where I saw that there was this gap in the market. And the more research I did, I realised that there was something called a virtual assistant out there. It was huge in the US, but not so commonly known in New Zealand. So the gap was that small to medium business owners, they are often feeling overwhelmed, they're trying to do everything themselves, because they can't afford, you know, in the startup phase, they can't afford to have that full-time, high-level executive assistant supporting them. Business owners often go into business because they're technically really good at something, and I'm talking, you know, about, say, traders are a really good example. They go into business because they're a really great electrician, but they don't actually know how to run their books or run their administration or provide that good customer service in terms of, you know, that communication back and forwards with the clients. Technically, you know, they could do a really great job, and you know, they might be great with the customer face to face, but there's a lot of stuff in the background, as you all know, to actually creating a good business and having that solid foundation. So that's where I knew that business owners who couldn't afford to have that full-time person, their options were to have hire a part-time person perhaps, or try and do it themselves. Now, hiring a part-time person means that they only have access to that person, say, on Monday, Wednesday, Friday from 9 to 2. Then what happens in those other hours when they still need someone available or they still need something done? So I created Strictly Savvy in 2012. Set it up with a business partner, and we both had the same background as EAs, and started providing those services to those business owners. Quickly grew. We very quickly had to start hiring others to help us. Over the next few years, we grew the company. This is where some of my learnings come in. So we thought that we would create another sort of side business doing the same thing, but providing trust account administration to law firms. We hired two people for that. We thought, yeah, this is great. It's the same sort of model as Strictly Savvy. Created all of the sort of the content and systems for that. Hired two people, and at the same time, we were growing Strictly Savvy. And what I hadn't realised in my it's the first business I've been in, is that growing is actually extremely expensive. You think that the revenue is going to keep coming in, and you know you can hire people and you can sustain that, but actually growing takes a lot of investment. So that working capital that we needed, I was paying people right at the start, you know, when they first came on board that first week, but then my clients weren't paying sometimes until 50, 60 days later, if I was lucky. So lots of lessons in there about not growing too fast, keeping that sustainable, having that working capital there to actually manage that. We had to close down the other company, and I had to reset everything. My business partner and I went our separate ways. We were no longer aligned in what we were wanting to do. So I bought her out and reset the company, and I've had it on my own now for a year. Gone from strength to strength now. So in that growth, we grew from 5 people to 12 people in a year, and we were hiring 2 at a time, and it just wasn't sustainable. So now, as I said before, I have hired 3 people last week, but I have learned 2 of my team members are going on maternity leave and 1 is going overseas, so these are replacements for them. So I had a goal this year to achieve $1 million in revenue, and I was so close, but I think it's probably going to be about 960,000, so about 40k shy. That will be my goal for next year, is to crack that $1 million in revenue and you know do even better. Some of the keys to my success: one is the low self doubt. We had a session with a consultant that we use to come in and do personality profiling on all of our team members, the DISC profile, so that we can all understand how we work together, which I highly recommend. It's been amazing for the business. But in one of those sessions, it was myself and two others in the team, and we were talking about the little voice in your head, that negative talk that you have. And she had asked all three of us, you know, what's the percentage of that talk that you have in the back of your head? What percentage of that is negative? And the two other people said about 80%. And I turned to them and looked and I thought, you've got to be joking, 80% negative talk. And she said, well, what's yours? And I said, oh, I think it maybe 5%. You know, maybe 10. I hadn't realised that the little voice in my head was so low and that negative, and I believed in myself and I had that low self-doubt, and I think that is one of the keys to my success. If I knew how to turn, for everyone else who is at that 80%, if I knew how to turn that off, I would let you know, but I actually don't. But that's one of the keys to my success. The second is being really open to ideas, opportunities, and always learning. So I'm always looking out for who I could partner with or how I could help another business. They could help me, you know, what we can do to support businesses and their growth. Monitoring, like, what tools and apps and new technology is out there so that, you know, we can streamline our business and then in turn help others. And they're always learning, so I sign up to lots of blogs, lots of successful people's newsletters, and I have a folder in my Outlook that I look at regularly and, you know, try and find those things to read. I read lots of things on LinkedIn. I have my own blog post that I put on LinkedIn as well, because I know that I am never going to know everything, and there's always opportunities to learn. Recently, Joy and I were actually, so Joy's my business development manager here, we were at like an invite-only workshop for like a coaching firm, and one of the attendees there, she had a business, and at one point she said that she knew more about her business than anyone could ever know, and that there's nothing really else that she could learn or do differently. And I thought, you've got to be joking again. You've got to be joking. You know, I would never, ever assume that I knew more about my business than anyone else. I have a coach, a business coach, and he's a fundamental part of my business. I wouldn't be doing it without him. And yeah, I just think that mindset is just not gonna get her places. So. Yeah, always learning, always asking questions and looking out for opportunities and ideas. The third key to my success, I think, is the ability to take action. I've actually written a blog post about this. Lots of people have ideas, but not that many people actually implement them and make them happen. And it's about being brave, not trying to achieve perfection. That's another thing that holds people back from actually taking action or releasing something that they want to, or writing something as they want it to be absolutely perfect. But yeah, if you're going to wait for that moment when it's going to be perfect, then you know, you're going to miss the boat. And yeah, be brave, face your fears, and yeah, just go for it, actually take that action. I'm not generally a procrastinator, especially if I can see that there's an opportunity for something. So yeah, those would be the three keys. What's next for Strictly Savvy and myself? This year, the previous financial year, was about getting that core virtual assistant service back up and running and building that great team. This year is about doing some things outside of that core service. I know that trading hours for dollars is not you know, the way of the future. It's never going to become a really profitable and exceptional business on its own right by doing that. So one of my goals this year is to create an online course. I'm going to teach executive assistants or personal assistants how to leave their 9-to-5 job and create a lifestyle business as a virtual assistant. So I'm going to talk to them about my learnings, how to go about that, securing clients, tools to use, and show people a different model to what I've done. So I've employed employees, but there's another model that can be created where you're just using contractors to complete work, and you know, you're the face of the company as a virtual assistant. So I'm going to teach them how to do that, and then create a whole range of courses on the back of that, but that will be the core course. So that will be my goal for this year. The other thing that we're doing is that we've secured a contract with MSD to provide a savvy business administration course to job seekers in the Wellington region. So in our office, we're lucky enough to have some vacant space in there. So at the moment, we're transforming one of the rooms into a really cool training room. So we're going to train 15 job seekers who are solo parents on a benefit. We've created the course so it's really accessible for those people. The course is run for 8 weeks. It's in a school term, so a week of school, and then they go on the course for 8 weeks, and then they have a week at the end to be able to, you know, do those things, setting their kids up for school, or you know, finishing up the school term. So 8 weeks from 8:45 to 2:45, so within the school hour, or the school day, so that they don't have to think about childcare outside of that. We're going to cover all sorts of things from bookkeeping and Xero, accounting principles. We've got an accountant coming in, and he's going to provide a presentation where he teaches people in a fun way accounting principles. So he has a bucket with lots of chocolates in it. The chocolate represents the revenue. It goes into the sales bucket. It then has to be distributed in other buckets, has to pay wages, overheads, and teaching people about, you know, it's not all of the revenue that comes in doesn't just go to a business owner. There's a lot of things that need to be taken into consideration. So a fun, interactive way to show that. We're going to teach them Word, Excel, and Outlook. Navigating a computer, Windows 10, tools and apps that they can use when they are in a job, and the sort of personal assistant key skills and principles, general like office admin skills, and we've got a lady who was a news anchor in the US for 20 years. She's going to come in and teach people about personal brand, how to present yourself, things to say, because we know that just coming on the course and then trying to go to an interview is not enough. So we're going to help them get more confidence in themselves, become motivated, confident in their skills, and be able to then present themselves in an interview situation to be able to secure that role. So that's going to happen 4 times over the next 12 months. And the part where you can be involved is that a key component in that course is going to be doing work experience, but not in the normal sense of what we think work experience is. So we're not going to send our trainees into businesses to undertake work experience. We're going to go out to businesses at the moment and asking them to think of projects and tasks that they could provide for our trainees to do remotely, so in the training room with their computer, and undertake that work to help them put those learnings into real life tasks for businesses. So this is an opportunity for everyone to think about how they can have some free admin support undertake some of those tasks for them. So I'll give you some examples about what they could do. So document layout and formatting in Word. So you might have a whole lot of documents, but they're not consistent. They don't have the same sort of format. You might have had a rebrand, and you need to actually put your logo and new colours across the documents. They could do online research for like staff or client gift ideas. They could come up with a whole lot of, you know, photos off the internet and find prices and present you back a document. They could research blog and newsletter article topics, listing them all out in a spreadsheet, you know, finding examples of blog posts that you could maybe repost on your blog. Coming up with social media post ideas and content in a Word document for you to have a look at. researching online for prices for a purchase that you might need to make. Tidying up a database. So you might have an old database that, you know, someone could research online and try and find the new person that's the CEO of a certain company, or, you know, have a tidy up of that database for you. You might have a stack of business cards. You might come to this event every month and have a stack of business cards on your desk that you haven't actually done anything with. Maybe they could log into your LinkedIn profile and connect with all those people on there and get your connections up. They might be able to take all of those business cards and actually list them out in an Excel document for you to upload into your contacts. Or typing from voice recordings. You might be wanting to start a blog, and you might be better at speaking into you know, your phone and actually speaking a blog post that they could type up for you. So the conditions around it are that the task must be able to be completed remotely, and it needs to be, they can only use Word, Excel, Outlook, and the internet to complete that task. Joy and I are actually going to go into the workplaces of the businesses and take a short video of you introducing yourself and your business and describing what the task is, explaining the task. And the reason why we wanted to do that is because we want the trainees to feel that connection with you, want to do a great job, feel like they're actually making a difference because it's a real life business and person that they get to do that for. So Strictly Savvy won't guarantee the accuracy or the take responsibility for quality controlling the work. So it needs to be at a level that you know, the trainees could undertake. They will have the assistance of the facilitator to help them with that task and all of the learning that they have. And that's about it. So how you can request a task to be completed is that Joy is going to be our contact person for that and coordinate it all. So Joy's business card is on the table and also on this flyer. And then we have an online application form where you fill in all of your details and describe the task and upload the documents that we need. And that goes through to one of our fancy tools that we use. So any questions?
I've got a quick question. You seem to promote a pretty open-ended type of association between each other. So how do you cost out on the is it a fee basis or
yep.
is it a fee basis? What is it?
Yeah. So because we've
maybe
been
you can't afford
it. So because we've been doing it for 5 years, we can pretty much gauge how long we think, or how many hours you would need to have for us to undertake that task for you. So how it works is that you would sign up to anywhere between 10 and 60 hours per month as your service plan. It's not a fixed fee for, you know, X service. It's an hourly-based service. So we track our time using an online tool called Harvest. Every minute of every day is tracked with my team members, and it's 100% productive time and focus time that they have their timer on and are working for you. And they keep you up to date with how they're going with the budget. If it's 45 hours for the month, they know that they've got about 10 hours a week, and they just keep you up to date with that. The two ways to engage us is either asking us to do a one-off sort of project, and that's where we will do a fixed price. So if it's like a document formatting, it's a graphic design, a branding project, whatever, a zero setup, we can do that. We estimate what it will be and provide that cost to you, and we undertake that project. The other way is to choose one of our service plans, which is the 10 to 60 hours per month. And we gauge that with you and communicate with you on the budget and how much we can get done in that time.
Confidentiality,
yep. So we use a password vault called LastPass. We have the enterprise version, which gives us full control over which team members have access to which passwords and logins. And our team members don't actually see what your password is. They are just able to use your password. The vault sort of protects that all. And absolutely, we can sign a confidentiality agreement with any of our clients if that's what they need and want. and we're very controlled about our access, our laptop security, and who has access to what documents and what folders, and that's all controlled from a central point. Yep, so we definitely invest in those tools to make sure that we can provide that to our clients.
So it sounds like you've hired a few people, and you might have got quite good at it. Can you talk about what's worked around hiring, like what things are really important when you're hiring and onboarding someone?
I've definitely learnt that fit for the team has always got to be number one. I can teach people the skills and what they need to know to undertake the job, but I can't teach people how to fit in with the team and to have a great attitude and work ethic. So when I am interviewing, I do a mini personality profile test to find out where they are in the DISC profile. I then am always looking and trying to find signs of whether they will fit into the team as I'm interviewing, more so than their skills. I do test skills as well, but that's definitely key for me. When you have a bad seed in the team, especially in a team of all women and all in open plan, it's not good.
Well, that's changed now.
One bloke, yes.
Have you ever thought about licensing it rather than, training people and letting them go off and do their own? Using your brand or
I have thought about that. My focus has been on getting the systems, the processes, the core services really working and streamlined first. And that is definitely something that I'm going to be thinking about over the next few years is licensing our brand.
Yeah.
But not too soon. I'm comfortable with where it's at the moment. Yeah, thank you.
Work-life balance.
Sorry?
Mine?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, I didn't talk about having a son.
I do have a son, yes. And a partner who also has a son is a merged family. And at the moment, work-life balance is definitely a struggle. And Lance is my partner behind you. He will definitely say that I can work too long and too hard sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
But we definitely book in holidays, we have long weekends. Now that I am in a position where I have a team, so I have Joy, who manages all of our leads and inquiries, I have team leaders in the team who can actually run the teams for me. So I'm definitely more in a position now to actually be able to step away for a week and have others run the company. And that was a really key moment for me, is when I have a trusted team that I don't need to be there day to day. So I definitely book in those holidays.
Can Lance verify that?
Yep.
Yeah. Over their Facebook page.
Yeah. We went wakeboarding for a long weekend last weekend.
And how could a guy you
are? Awesome. Oh, look, thanks, Joe. Thanks very much for today.
You mentioned that